Welcome to New York City and to Columbia University. I'm Lisa Metsch, and I have the honor to chair our Department of Sociomedical Sciences at Columbia University's Mailman School of Public Health. We here at the Mailman School of Public Health are so excited about serving as a national convener today to host the critical view of incarceration within a public health frame. We feel our location here in New York City is an ideal location to have this conversation. There are so many innovators working in this field from our colleagues at John Jay, College of Criminal Justice, Vera Institute, the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. So we feel very fortunate to be able to be in this great city. We are thrilled today to have so many of you as partners in this dialogue. We are so excited to have at this conference over 50 schools of public health and public health programs represented here today. Thank you for joining us in this such important conversation. I just would like to mention, to take one moment to talk about what we've done in the past. This is the third time that we've brought schools of public health together under the leadership of Dean Freed. In 2012, our school hosted the Changing Landscape of Global Health, where we looked to bring with you to tackle issues regarding the world's changing health needs and the essential role that public health must play in addressing them. Last year, many of you joined us where we held a conference on innovations in public health education. It was a summit where we all shared with each other innovations that we were doing at our own schools in the areas of education. And we were able to, at that conference, launch our new core curriculum in public health. So we really see this conference as a tradition. I'll be introducing our dean in a moment. I want to acknowledge Mrs. Phyllis Mailman, who is here from the Mailman family that has been so generous and partners in our school. For this year, we gave the conference the title, Opportunities for Action, because we feel that at this time, it's so important for public health leadership to delve into this issue of incarceration and its alternatives, and to look at it from every angle. There is so much that public health can contribute to this conversation. Many of us have been at conferences that have addressed the issue of mass incarceration, and many of us are aware of the challenges that our country faces on this issue. But we hope that this conference will be taking it to the next step. We want this conference to be about action. Many of you have shared with us what you are doing at your schools in terms of developing new curriculum, working with your local law enforcement and your local prisons and jails to create innovative educational policies. We're hoping at this conference that we can talk about how involving our MPH students and our graduate students to train them to be the next generation to bring the public health frame to these issues. We're hoping that we can talk today how we can bring that public health voice and awareness in the media, how we can work more effectively with legislators to change public health policies, and most importantly, to find ways of deploying the public health frame and voice into local communities and institutions where they can be acted upon to change. I'm sure you've all read a lot of things that have been in the media and in the newspapers lately. I was particularly struck this weekend by Alice Goffman's piece in the Sunday New York Times, where she suggests that the question we might also ask is not whether an individual should be punished for an act of violence, but where is that violence coming from and how might we prevent it? We really need to take an approach and look at the fundamental causes here. The conference goal is to have a forward-thinking conversation together as leaders of public health about what we can achieve by focusing a public health lens on incarceration in the United States. As I mentioned before, we hope to act by building essential partnerships, expanding research, collaborating with local communities, implementing innovative and educational strategies, and ultimately getting the public health voice into the media to all to have an impact on public policy. Before this conference, we asked many of you to send us abstracts and a write-up of what you're doing at your School of Public Health, and we've compiled that for you. And we know that this is a moving target, and hopefully this conference will generate new ideas for us all to act together. We hope and really ask that you not just sit and listen, but that you be an active voice. We will have sessions and panels that are organized around these areas, and we've asked some of you in the room to lead on the panels, but we really hope to cut those short and then to open up the room for a dialogue. We hope we will have fresh, new ideas, because that's what this field really needs. Before going much further, I want to offer thanks and gratitude to the Tau Foundation for their vision, leadership, understanding, and support. On a personal note, I just want to say to Emily Tau Jackson, who has been my partner throughout the planning and execution of this conference. I still remember today when we were sitting in a conference room and wanting to develop a conference and just feeling that this was the right thing to do at this time, to bring schools of public health together. So we are so excited about that. I also want to acknowledge the foundations of the Tau Foundation president, Dr. Len Tau, and the wonderful staff of the Tau Foundation, Diana Serpina, Andrea Scholler, for also being partners with us. Also, I'm going to start the conference by thanking the team, because we may not get the chance, who really worked for months. And really, I will be here 2 years in July. And Dean Fried, actually, when she was recruiting me, this was an idea. And she'll share, you know, with you how she's been really touched by this issue for so long. But we've been working on this conference. My colleague, Dr. Amanda Geller, who is an assistant professor in sociomedical sciences, Chelsea Davis, Kim Millian, Jill Barkan, Debbie Rosenberg-Bush, and Peter Tabak. So please join me in thanking them for all the work they did for this conference. I also want to say that this has been a journey getting here, and we have several intellectual partners in New York City. I want to acknowledge, and the dean will as well, that we have a group of faculty that have been our think tank, our intellectual force for our school's efforts in this area. And I've had the pleasure of leading this with Ernie Drucker. I also want to acknowledge that we are so fortunate to be at a great university that has recognized this issue. And there is the Columbia Justice Initiative, which has brought people from all schools at Columbia University to focus on this issue. And Kathy Boudin and Cheryl Wilkins are the co-directors of that initiative. Geraldine Downey, I believe, is in the room, who's also been involved. There's a very strong focus at the School of Social Work. And I have a partner in Nabila El-Bassel, and she and I are leading a training grant. There's also the Punishment of Public Health Capabilities for a New Ecology of Justice. And there's an academy where John Jay College, NYU, CUNY School of Public Health, and we've been part of that, Vera Institute. So there's been a lot of effort and work in the city focusing on this, and really, as we know, throughout our country. But we are so thrilled to be, this is, to our knowledge, the first time where we've had a formal conference where we've invited all the schools of public health to come together, and we're just so excited to be here. I just want to mention that if your school or program is not represented in the book we've put together, we have a website set up. We want to keep working with you and tracking. The most important thing is this conference is just getting us started. We hope that we will develop new collaborations and networks to keep things going after the conference and for many years to come, because we have a lot of work to get done together. So now is my pleasure to introduce our visionary here at the School of Public Health, Dean Linda Fried. Dean Fried is the Senior Vice President of the Columbia University Medical Center. She is the Delamar Professor of Public Health. She's a professor of epidemiology and medicine. Dr. Fried is internationally renowned scientist in the fields of epidemiology, gerontology, and geriatrics. She has dedicated her career to the science of preventing frailty and chronic diseases and creating healthy aging. And you'll see, even from that field, she has some new thoughts even for this in this area as well. She's an elected member of the Institute of Medicine and of the Association of American Physicians, where she serves as on the Executive Council. She is the recipient of numerous honors and awards and is a member of the World Economics Forum's Council on Aging Society. Again, although incarceration and these issues that we're going to be discussing today is not her primary focus, she has had the vision and inspiration to challenge us at the School of Public Health to take on this issue. She's always pushing the public health. She's always pushing prevention science with all of us. I just want to personally thank her for investing generously, not only intellectually, but also materially in weaving this issue into the fabric and the DNA of our school. So it is my great pleasure to introduce Dean Linda Fried.
Well, good morning. This is a moment we've all been waiting for quite a long time, and I couldn't be more thrilled to have the opportunity to join Dr. Metsch and all of us in thanking you for coming together on what I believe is a deeply critical issue for our well-being and future as a society. I wanted to start by thanking Dr. Metsch for her leadership of really in the creation of the vision for this meeting and for shepherding all of us together into a shared vision and even the room. So Lisa, thank you. And thank you also to the whole committee that organized today's event. And I want to add my own thanks to Emily Tao Jackson and Dr. Len Tao, without whose support on every level today would never have happened. So to Emily and Len, you are amazing partners in vision and creation. Thank you. In addition to Dr. Tao's role, of course, as chair of the Tao Foundation, we're extremely fortunate that he's a member of the Mailman School's Board of Overseers. I also want to add my thanks to Phyllis Mailman for being here. Phyllis, thank you. And for your ongoing, strong, even feisty partnership. And I think there may be some other members of our Board of Overseers, Richard Eisner and Julia Wasserman, who are in the room, although I can't see them from here. So let's start with the issue. And although my remarks will be brief, I hope that I can contribute to the framing here. What's brought us all together are these data that there in the late 20th century and to the present, the rates of incarceration in the United States have risen dramatically, on and on and on and up in that bright blue bar going from the bottom left to the top right, while actually rates of crimes have gone down. There is a large gap that is in the differential between the rising rates of incarceration and the falling nationwide crime trends. And people like Ernie Drucker, who are here, have written very eloquently saying that these rates of incarceration have taken on a life of their own, and as an epidemiologist, I can resonate with his arguments that they've taken on the characteristics of a self-propelling epidemic. The outcome is that by now it's widely known that the United States has the highest rates of incarceration in the world. While we have 5% of the world's population, we have 25% of the world's prisoners. And there is growing documentation that the consequences are traumatic, disastrous, and enduring for the individuals who are incarcerated, for their families, for their communities, and increasingly we recognize for our society. And these data, if you dig down a little deeper, are, of course, characterized by stark racial disparities. Here you see the data on the first incarceration among men in the United States. And what you see is that the differential of likelihood of incarceration for the first time varies tremendously by age, but particularly even more than age by race. So that over time, 29% of black males in the United States have been or will be incarcerated, 16% of Hispanic males, and 4% of white males. The likelihood of imprisonment is sixfold higher for black males than whites and 2.5-fold higher for Hispanic males. So looking at these data, it's been very clear for quite a while to the criminal justice community that this is a criminal justice issue, that there are a number of factors that came together to drive and exacerbate the nature of these data. So we have to ask, should public health be engaged? And if so, why? And I would like to lay out to you the argument that public health and incarceration and justice issues are inextricably linked in both the causes of these incarceration rates, the causes of causes, and in the solutions we need to put together. This is a very propitious moment. It's actually an amazing moment. Although we've been building toward this moment within the Mailman School for well over 4 years, yesterday in the New York Times, it was reported that New York City's Mayor de Blasio announced the creation of the administration's first major criminal justice initiative intended to reduce the rate of incarceration among New Yorkers with mental illness. Entitled the Task Force on Behavioral Health and the Criminal Justice System, the goals that Mayor de Blasio announced are to seek alternatives to arrest and prosecution. We will see today and discuss, I'm sure, substantially how many of these need to come from public health. In fact, Mayor de Blasio said yesterday, and I quote, "For far too long, our city's jails have acted as de facto mental health facilities," unquote. And then on May 30th, which is only a few days ago, President Obama issued the report of his My Brother's Keeper Task Force, a long time in coming. It was convened by President Obama to address persistent opportunity gaps faced by boys and young men of color and to place a lens on our society that would help us see how to ensure that all young people can reach their full potential. The president charged that task force with providing incentives to learn and do what works to address these gaps. Their results are here, that there are adverse exposures and lower opportunity across the life course of young people in this country that are predictors and precipitators of this school-to-prison pipeline that we so glibly describe, that leads so many young people to be at risk of ending up in jail, and these vary by race and ethnicity. And overall, the president's task force recommended that the criminal justice system in our society need to take a life course approach to provide young people with the tools and opportunities to succeed. The task force on Friday called for comprehensive cradle-to-college and career strategies rooted in local communities. And it called for a phrase very familiar to public health professionals, which is to take a life course approach to provide young people with the tools and opportunities to succeed. This report was focused on the need to ensure that children enter school ready to learn, that they read at grade level by third grade, that they graduate from high school ready for college and career, that they complete post-secondary education or training, and then they can successfully enter the workforce. But the president also suggested that we need a life course approach to prevention on the public health side. He said that in several ways. He said that we need to reduce violence in high-risk communities by integrating public health approaches. That yes, we need to reform juvenile and criminal justice systems and promote alternative approaches, successful alternatives to incarceration, just as Mayor de Blasio announced yesterday. And that we need to recognize the importance of parents and other caring adults and advise on how our collective responsibility should be deployed. This conference's organizers, propitiously, the next day after Mayor de Blasio's announcement and 4 days after President Obama's, we have posited that we can build on President Obama's charges and identify together the public health components that will create this life course approach. And I would argue that there are four main frames that we may want to consider through this conference in thinking about that. The first, of course, are the public health contributors and roles and that moment of incarceration when illegal behaviors are confronted by our criminal justice system and an individual ends up in jail. And what are those precipitants of impulsive behaviors, illegal actions, perhaps moments of violence? But we also know that there are exposures and severe health risks that people experience when in jail. And beyond that, they carry their life experience of being in jail back to their communities through their children, through their spouses, through their broader families, and through their communities, which are deeply affected by this large proportion of young men of color in particular who are in jail. And there are ancillary health consequences and ancillary consequences to the future of the whole family and community as well as the individual from this experience. And we also know that when discharged, there is a high rate of recidivism, a high risk for ending up back in jail. And approaches such as our young men's clinic in Washington Heights, led out of the Mailman School of Public Health, have been developed to work with young men of color discharged from prison to create the basis for a healthy and successful reentry into a community and a new life, and to try and prevent this vicious cycle of jail and reentry to jail. But we know one other thing. Public health research marries with President Obama and Mayor de Blasio in understanding that there are deep roots to the disadvantage that creates the school-to-prison pipeline. There are deep roots of many adverse exposures that young people growing up in poverty in the society experience. There are deep roots in terms of exposures to violence and the traumas that bring to young people's mental well-being, and exposures to environmental harms that affect their ability to learn and to grow. We know that the risk of poverty is very high by differentials by race and ethnicity for young people. We know that half to three quarters of young African Americans and Hispanics are growing up in households of single parents, where a father's absence increases the risk of dropping out by 75 to 96%. We know that exposure to violence harms people in themselves, and we know that black males are 43% of the murder victims in per year in this country. And homicide is the leading cause of death for black males. And we know that dropping out of school sets people up in a way that is harmful for the rest of their lives. So how can we as public health professionals think about this whole cycle of issues where public health as well as criminal justice has a role to play, and where sometimes our approaches are the flip side of each other? In fact, public health lens, which many in the audience know well, is to figure out what the how to apply the Institute of Medicine's definition of public health, the actions we must take collectively to assure the health of our population, and to make sure that we attend to the primary prevention of the risks and the cumulative disadvantages that drive young people into those moments of incarceration. The secondary prevention that could lead to better outcomes, alternatives to incarceration, alternatives to care, alternatives to reentry, and tertiary prevention that will prevent recidivism and prevent the deleterious effects of incarceration on individuals, families, and communities so we can rebuild people's health, their well-being, and they and their families' lives. So President Obama is calling for a life course approach to prevention on the side of education in particular, and are building the social institutions that protect the ability of our young people to succeed and provide the supports and nurturance that every young person in this society needs and many are not getting, as many of our social institutions have withered over the last 30 years. But there are many other dimensions of a life course on the public health side, and how we build, how we understand those, how we ensure that they are put in place at every age and stage of life to ensure successful development, and each stage building on the well-being and success of the other is core to a 21st century approach to public health. And in fact, because the flip side of public health so often is what criminal justice has to deal with. And our approaches may be the solutions that the criminal justice community is often seeking, that we need to think together, to think out of the box, as well as with evidence, to innovate in large ways, to figure out how we create and harness social capital in all dimensions to solve these issues together, which threaten our collective future, and then to partner on solutions. Now, President Obama's task force noted that the presence and engagement of parents and other caring adults is and always will be the greatest difference in these young people's lives. And I'd like to end by citing one area of social capital that we always leave on the table, just to stimulate you to think about the others too. Because we have the social capital to solve this if we organize correctly to do it. So one area of social capital, which I've spent a lot of my career trying to think about, is how to create win-wins between the older population, because we are an aging society, and we are about to have a population where we have one older adult for every child in the United States, as well as around the world. And we leave all of this social capital on the table when we have a one-to-one match. I've spent the last 25 years working on one model to demonstrate that older adults have an immense amount to contribute to the life course success of our young people. Experience Corps is the model that I designed, and it works by deploying a critical mass of trained older adults in public elementary schools to secure the academic success of children. But there are many other models that we need. But we can't leave any social capital or social institutions unexamined and undeployed in what I believe is a societal emergency. So I'll end by thanking my own colleagues who are really doing the heavy lifting on all of this, and look to the Mailman School of Public Health, Incarceration and Public Health Initiative for your ongoing leadership, really visionary leadership on these issues. I want to thank Lisa Metsch and Ernie Drucker, who have co-led this whole initiative, who have led a think tank over the last several years on how to actually formulate a public health lens on the issues of incarceration, how to educate our own faculty, research staff, and students about the extent and nature of mass incarceration and the criminal justice public health intersections and the role of population health approaches. I'm thrilled that we have just been awarded an NIH training grant, co-led by Lisa Metsch and Nabila El-Basil from the School of Social Work, to actually provide a model for training to lead public health in these areas. And this think tank has been deeply invested in advancing the state of knowledge of the interactions between mass incarceration and public health, as well as trying to identify the most effective approaches to primary, secondary, and tertiary prevention. And ultimately, our goal, as is all of yours, is to lay the evidence-based groundwork to directing and influencing public policy related to incarceration and public health. And we are here today, hopefully, to do it better than we could ever do it alone. So thank you so much. Again, I thank the leaders of this initiative within the Mailman School, who have been really game to do an immense amount of out-of-the-box thinking, building on their own work, long-standing work in these areas, and welcome you again to this important conference where we're all in to learn. Thank you.